One of the things which hurts those of us in the medical world sometimes is that it's very hard to get Christian people, church leaders and so on, to engage with these issues. They're sometimes they're too painful, they're too difficult, they're too complicated. It's much safer to stay with our traditional approaches. But these are the issues which so many people within our church communities are struggling with. And they're issues which we have a chance to stand up as a community that is behaving in a completely different way and is demonstrating the reality of the Christian faith in a way which makes a difference. So I'm going to carry on some of the themes which Peter has raised, and just some brief mentions about some issues at the end of life. We won't be able to discuss issues of euthanasia and assisted suicide with any great detail, but if there, we would be happy to discuss those in the questions later on. But it's helpful to see that Christian thinking about death is always fundamentally ambiguous about human death. On the one hand, human death is a great enemy. It's not part of the original plan for human beings. It's the consequence of evil and rebellion. And so death is the final enemy. And healthcare professionals fight against death with all their ability, with their conviction. We're called to try and hold back, to keep death at bay. But there are situations where death changes from being the great enemy, and where it can actually become, in a strange way, a mercy, a form of grace. If you remember in the Garden of Eden, when the first human beings are driven out of the Garden of Eden, there's an angel and a flashing sword that is there to prevent them from getting back into the Garden of Eden. And the reason is to prevent them from eating from the tree of the fruit of life and living forever. Because to live forever in a fallen state is not a blessing, it's a curse. And so the angel is, and the sword is kept there to prevent the fallen human beings living forever. Part of God's grace. So death can become a severe mercy, it can become a healing. It can become a gateway to a new kind of reality. And therefore, the challenge which faces Christian health professionals is to try to fight against death while trying to recognize the point at which death changes from an enemy to being a severe mercy. And at that point, the right thing to do is to stop the fight, to allow death to occur, and to allow the ultimate healing to occur beyond, through the gateway of death, to a new reality. And it's thinking like this that's why Christian people were the ones who invented palliative care as a way of helping people to die well. So our calling is not to introduce death into a situation. We don't have that right. So euthanasia and assisted suicide is to introduce death into a situation where it isn't. But it is right sometimes for us to allow death that is already there, to take our hands away, to allow death to occur. And so good medicine must know its limits. It must know when to say enough is enough, when death changes from an enemy to be resisted into a gateway to a new existence, a strange form of healing. And that's something that we need to discuss and learn together and to teach one another, the point at which we say enough is enough. Sometimes Christian people feel that they must fight against death and use all the technology in a way which is unhelpful. And so sometimes it is right to say enough is enough and allow death to occur, because we have a hope which goes beyond the grave. The great preacher Martin Lloyd-Jones was being kept alive at the end of his life by medical technology, and he is said to have complained to his doctors caring for him. He said, "You are keeping me from the glory." And so there is a time to say, enough is enough. And our calling is to be with those who are suffering. I love this anonymous quotation. Suffering is not a question which demands an answer. It's not a problem which demands a solution. It's a mystery which demands a presence. The calling which God has given us is to be a presence to people who are suffering. It is to be God's love mediated in physical form with those who are suffering. The challenges which are facing us are extraordinary because of the new science. Now, this is the science which is coming in the future. But as we look into the future, it seems inevitable that this new science is going to transform and change the nature of humanity. So there is science working on genetics, on the understanding of the human DNA code. A huge amount of effort is now available, has been performed to analyze human DNA. And in future, it would be possible for the entire genetic code to be obtained from a baby before birth, to allow parents to make decisions about whether or not to have an abortion, and to be obtained at all stages through life. There is new forms of technology which is changing, making artificial kinds of body parts and restoring where the body has become worn out. There is synthetic biology, where human beings are able now to create living cells. And in the future, it's thought that this kind of synthetic biology will be used for manufacturing. So rather than have machines which are doing our manufacturing, it's much more powerful to have living cells designed and created by human beings, which will then be making the manufacturing processes. There is new understandings of neuroscience, of looking into the brain, new kinds of medicines, pharmacology, which will not just be used for treating disease, but will be used to giving us greater intellectual ability, used for suppressing memories, bad memories, used for changing our emotions, used for increasing our ability to stay awake. All these are... sounds like some of you need it at the moment. So there's new forms of nanotechnology, which is using the incredibly small, and new kinds of robotics, where all of these technologies are converging together, and they are driven by the power of the digital revolution. And because digital power increases exponentially, every 2 years the power doubles. It means, therefore, that the power of this technology is almost without limit. The Economist magazine had a section on this. They called it biology 2.0. This was a completely new kind of biology. They said it will lead to better medical diagnosis and treatment, will explain the history of life, and it will reveal in pitiless detail exactly what it is to be human. Do you notice that? We want to, modern human beings want to understand what it means to be human, and they hope that the technology, the science, will reveal exactly what it is to be human. So one way which human beings are trying to understand this is to compare their DNA with a chimpanzee DNA. And people are matching by single base by base, because if we can understand the difference between a chimpanzee and then a human being, then we will really understand what it means to be human. The Economist magazine said there will be mistakes on the way and suffering too, but technology, once invented, cannot be unlearned. We are as gods and might as well get good at it. Now, if that doesn't frighten you, I don't know what does. But you can see here the hubris. We have become the gods, and so we might as well get good at it. I think one of the both very interesting and powerful but quite threatening areas is the area of neuroscience, because sophisticated brain scans are being performed to look at every aspect of mental functioning, and that includes religious belief. So brain scans are being performed of people while they're praying. They're looking to see what happens in our brains. How are the brains of religious people different from non-religious people? And, of course, there is the belief that religion is the greatest threat to modern civilization. There are many people who now believe, like the old Enlightenment view, it is religion that will destroy us. And so we have to understand where these crazy religious beliefs come from. We have to understand the brain mechanisms. And then we're going to use this understanding in order to try to prevent religion from becoming the threat. So you can see a potential risks and damages in this area. And that's why we need people. I don't have any easy answers in this area, but I think we can see that we need people to engage with these issues in order to develop Christian responses. This is an American company called No Lie MRI. And the idea is that you can stick somebody in the magnetic scanner and you can test whether they're telling the truth or not by seeing the responses in the brain scans. And it's being suggested that brain scans will be used for employment testing to see whether people are suitable for different kinds of employment. They're going to be used in law courts. They're going to be used in scientific research and so on. Behind all this is the idea that human beings are just determined. We are playthings of other forces. And historically, there's always been the attempt to believe that human beings are just determined. So astrology, political determinism, psychological determinism, which is Freud, social determinism, economic determinism. Then the new versions of determinism are genetic determinism and neurological determinism. But it seems to me that biblical Christianity stands out against all these and says, no, we are not just the playthings. We are not just puppets determined by other forces. God has given us the freedom to be independent, choosing agents, and we are accountable for the choices that we make. So yes, we are influenced by many things because of our humanity, because of the way we are created. But ultimately, we have the freedom to choose, and we will be held accountable for the choices we make. But the idea is, if human beings are merely machines, then we can exploit them for our own purposes. And so some human beings become the raw material on which other human beings can operate. Do you know where the greatest research into human enhancement is going on? Well, it's the US military, which is investing millions of dollars in trying to find ways of machine brain interfaces so the fighter pilot can control the plane or the gun without actually using arms at all, simply by thinking, by developing new ways. If soldiers can be made smarter, then they can be more effective in warfare. So again, you see the potential for this kind of technology. And the philosophy of transhumanism says human nature is just work in progress, a half-baked beginning that can be remolded in desirable ways through the intelligent use of enhancement technologies. So again, just some Christian responses. In biblical thinking, biblical ethics, the way we treat one another comes from biblical anthropology, the way we are made. And therefore, we need to develop a more profound understanding, a biblical and theological understanding of our creation, of what it means to be an embodied human being made in God's image. And what the Genesis narrative teaches us is that human beings are not self-explanatory. We derive our meaning from outside ourselves. Because God said, let us make human beings in our image, in our likeness. Human beings are godlike beings, and therefore our meaning comes from our godlikeness. Each human life is not only a gift from God, it is a reflection of his being, of his character. And so you will never understand what it means to be a human being unless you understand that. But then, most amazingly and wonderfully, when God breaks into human history, he doesn't come in some totally new kind of being, humanity 2.0. No, he comes as an original model human being. He makes himself utterly and totally defenseless and vulnerable and dependent. And he goes through the narrative of a human life. And then ultimately, in the physical resurrection of Jesus, as he's raised as Jesus, the new Adam, as he's raised as a physical, tangible, recognizable human being, we see God's final and eternal vote of confidence in the original human model. In other words, we don't need to have a new, enhanced kind of humanity, because in the person of Jesus, this kind of humanity, this kind of flesh, is not abandoned, despised, or marginalized. It is affirmed and fulfilled. And that is, I think, the unique message which we have as Christians have to say when confronted by the challenges of the technology. If original model humanity was good enough for Jesus, then perhaps it's good enough for us too, that we don't need to have this desperate desire to have a better kind of humanity. We accept the way that we've been made because that's the one that God has chosen to vindicate and fulfill in the person of Jesus Christ. So what are some practical responses? Well, you know, whenever we say that something is wrong, we must immediately say, and here is a better way. It's not good enough just to say, it's wrong, it's wrong, it's wrong. We must say, here is a better way. So there have been some wonderful Christian initiatives in a number of countries around the world, but in the area at the beginning of life, it's particularly the crisis pregnancy centres. Christian crisis pregnancy centres, it's been a wonderful move of God in a number of countries. They're providing compassionate and practical support for couples facing a crisis of unwanted pregnancy. They're also providing counselling for women and men who suffer from post-abortion distress. Many men are affected by these issues, not just women. They're providing sex and relationships education for school children. And then at the end of life, it's Christians who've been at the forefront of the development and provision of skills, palliative care for the terminally ill, and who've opposed the legalization of euthanasia and assisted suicide. So here are some practical responses of ways in which Christian people have made a difference. So now, time for some small group questions, and then we're going to have a chance for some question and answer session as a group as a whole. But the questions which I'd like you then to turn again into your groups is to say, what practical steps in my context can the Christian community take to defend and protect the most vulnerable human lives? And how can emerging technologies with their extraordinary power be used not to manipulate, distort and destroy, but to preserve and better fulfill our humanness in line with God's purposes for humankind?